good Sunday morning, church. Good to be coming to you live today from here in the sanctuary. So thankful for all of you tuning in. I was just watching as everybody was getting online, seeing your faces pop up and seeing your avatars pop up from your Facebook pages. It's good to see you. Good to have you here to worship with us this morning. So thankful that you took the time out of your day to come worship the Lord today. What a wonderful and beautiful Lord's Day it is. And I'm thankful that you will pause your beautiful day. And I know many of you probably are busy today, but you'll pause that for a time to worship God. This is still the Lord's Day. Amen. And I'm thankful that you're honoring the Lord's Day and you've come to worship the Lord this morning. I'm excited about this morning, excited about the worship that we're going to have today. Excited because God is good. Amen. I'm so thankful for His goodness this morning, thankful for His mercy and the new graces each and every day. Aren't you thankful that God's mercies are new, His graces are new each and every day? What a wonderful blessing that is, that no matter what we went through yesterday, today is a new day. And God's blessings and God's graces and God's mercies are new each and every day. The Bible says, sorrow may last or crying may last for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. I'm thankful for His joy that I have in my heart today because I know Him as my personal Savior. So let's worship this morning. Let's give God glory. He's worthy to be worshiped today. Amen. And so thankful for that. We got some singing for you coming up. So in looking forward to that. Just God just really showed out this morning as she was practicing those songs. Had no idea what Miss Anna would be singing this morning. She began to sing. And it's a song that God's been playing in my head all week this week. And God knows how to line up the service, doesn't He? Amen. Let's worship Him today. Got just a couple of announcements I want to give you. Then we're going to move right into the worship service. As you know, we have decided, the leadership of the church and I have decided to continue to do our online Facebook Live services for the next few weeks in order to keep everyone safe. That means that we are projecting and looking at May the 24th being the first day that we will come back and have services here in the sanctuary. That's only 2 weeks, amen. That's 3 weeks from now. Two more Sundays that we'll have this, and then we'll get to come back together. That excites me, amen. So, of course, we will have safety precautions in place. Of course, we are looking at that date. If something changes between then, we may have to adjust, but that's the date we're looking for. With that being said, we also know that May the 17th is our normal Memorial Day service, our Decoration Day here at Ephesus Baptist Church. And because we won't be here, we will not have our normal Memorial Day service here inside the sanctuary like we normally do. We will have an online Facebook Live service again, but we will not have our memorial service. But what we will have is the cemetery there. You'll be free to go in. Make sure that you decorate the graves. You know, remember those that we've lost this year and those that we lost that's gone on to be with the Lord. Decorate those graves. Make that graveyard look beautiful like you always do. And you can still come to the graveyard. You can walk out through it. You can remember those. You can spend time there. Please feel free to do that. But we will not have a service inside the church on that day. But the next Sunday, looking forward to having you back here in the church house and worshiping the Lord. Amen. Also, I sent out a call and post this week for you to pray for Brother Larry Wayne Nichols, Ms. Patsy's husband. He had suffered a stroke this week. I just talked to her this morning, and she said he is doing much better this morning. He is making improvement. He did have a stroke, and he's lost some use of his left side, and he will be going to rehab, probably going to rehab Tuesday or so. They'll get him into there and get him rehab. So you continue to pray for him. Pray for Ms. Patsy as well and the family. And pray that he continues to improve. Got one more thing I want to share with you, and then we're going to get right into the singing. The Pregnancy Resource Center sent us, I read a thank you card from them a few weeks ago, but they sent us a paper telling us about the baby bottle boomerang. You know, we all fill up our baby bottles with a change or checks or money, and we bring those in and make that donation to the Pregnancy Resource Center. And right now, the Carrollton Baptist Association has raised $64,164.26 for this Pregnancy Resource Center. What a wonderful, wonderful news that we heard there. And they still have bottles coming in. With that being said, our church, Ephesus Baptist Church, has donated and contributed $1,801.42. So I'm so thankful for you, church, putting value on the life of these young babies and, you know, donating to this Pregnancy Resource Center so lives can be saved and women's lives can be changed, all for the glory and the honor of God today. Amen. Well, it's good to be in the Lord's house today. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer at this time. I'm going to ask Miss Anna to come. She's going to sing, and then we're going to preach. We're going to worship God today. So wherever you're at, whatever you're doing, let's worship God. Let's give Him honor and glory, and let's have a good time in the Lord today. Let us pray. Lord, we come to You this day. We're so thankful, Lord, for the opportunity, Lord, to come to You. Lord, there is joy in my heart this morning. Oh, that joy can only be placed there through the relationship with Jesus. Lord, I'm thankful, Lord, that no matter what may go on in this world, no matter what trials or troubles we have, God, that relationship that I have with Christ is enough. And Lord, it brings joy, brings happiness in my life. And Lord, I'm feeling it this morning. I'm thankful to be able to worship. We pray that You would help us, Lord, to worship in spirit and in truth wherever we may be. Let us focus on You and what You've done for us. Lord, let us apply what You're going to share with us through the Word of God today to our lives. And let our lives be a light for You in this lost and dark world. I pray, Lord, for Miss Anna as she comes sings, anoint her voice, fill her with the Holy Ghost, God, and just allow her to sing honor and glory unto You, Lord. And Lord, that's what we want to do. We want to lift You up today, Lord. We want to magnify You today, for You're worthy. You've been so good to us. Lord, we just pray that You continue to move in our midst, in our time. Lord, be with our leaders, be with our communities, be with our sick, God, and just help us, God, to be more like You each and every day. I thank You for Jesus, Lord. I thank You that He died on the cross. Lord, I thank You that He shed His precious blood. Lord, I thank You that He got up on the third day and arose again. Lord, I'm thankful for one day when He knocked on my heart, God, and He said, I love You. And I want to save you. God, I praise You for that this morning, God. And I pray if there's one that's never accepted Him, God, I pray the day would be the day, Lord, that they come to know You as Lord and Savior. Lord, they'd have joy in their heart. They'd have worship in their life. Lord, You'd be honored and glorified. Lead, God, direct us. Have Your will and way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Come on, listen. Thank you.
Finish well. Boy, I've been playing that on my playlist all week long. Had no idea she was planning to sing that this morning. But boy, what a blessing. One of my favorite preachers that I listen to a lot, Brother C.T. Townsend, preached a message a while back, and it was called, Are You Finished or Will You Finish? I'm glad today that I'm going to finish. I've determined in my heart that no matter what I face, it's not going to finish me, but I'm going to finish well because I know the Lord, because He gives me the power, He gives me the ability to finish the race that He has set us upon. And I believe this morning, church, I think that there is a, I think our time is drawing near. I think we can almost see the finish line.
Amen.
And this is the question you must ask this morning. Are you going to be finished or will you finish? Well, all that's gone on in the last few months with this virus, for many they would say, well, I'm just finished. I'm finished with this world. I'm finished with trying to do right. I'm finished with all this. And the virus or the problem that you may be going through may be finishing you. Or you can say, no matter what comes, no matter what I go through, no matter what this virus brings, I'm going to continue to press toward the mark.
Yes,
I'm going to continue to go where God calls me to go. I'm going to continue to do what God calls me to do.
Yes.
And I'm going to finish my race. I'm going to press toward the mark. And I'm going to finish the course. Amen. And when I get to heaven, and when Jesus calls me into His precious, to His precious presence,
amen,
He'll say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Well, I'm thankful for a Lord that will give us the courage to finish. Amen. I pray that you'll finish the course God has put you on with grace and with truth today. Amen. What a glorious day it is. I want you to turn in your Bibles if you have one this morning. I pray that you do. If you don't, I pray that you just follow along with me. But Genesis chapter number 50. Genesis chapter number 50, we're going to talk about a man this morning that actually finished well. Amen. God knew exactly what he was doing when he put all this together. There were some things that took place in the life of this individual that we're going to study this morning that could have finished him, that could have ended his race, that could have ended his walk, could have ended his faith, could have ended all that he had. But he put faith in the Lord, and he continued to walk, and he continued to follow, and he continued to trust in God. And because of that, he finished well. And the chronicles of his life are recorded in the sacred, infallible, perfect Word of God this morning. And you and I can look at it. We can take a look into it with our own eyes and apply the truths that he lived out in his life to ours and finish well as well. So I'm thankful this morning. I'm talking about a man named Joseph this morning. Joseph, the son of Jacob. The one that was sold into slavery down into Egypt. The one that was put in prison from Potiphar's house. The one that was remembered after he was in prison, remembered by one of the servants of Pharaoh, and was brought before Pharaoh and interpreted his dream. And because of that, Pharaoh elevated him to a perfect, for the second in command, elevated him to a place of prominence, and because of that, he was able to preserve the family of God. He was able to preserve the line of Abraham. He was able to preserve and prolong that family. And can I tell you something this morning? Because of what he did, because of who he was, because that he prolonged and he preserved the family line of Abraham, because of that, later on down the line, there was a person born to a young virgin girl named Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Because Jesus Christ was born, you and I have redemption this
yes.
morning.
Amen.
Because he died on the cross and shed his precious blood. Because he was put in a borrowed tomb. Because on the third day he arose again. Because of Abraham, because of Joseph persevering. Because of Joseph finishing his course. We have Jesus, and because we have Jesus, we have salvation this morning.
Amen.
And because I got salvation, I got hope today, amen.
Yes.
Because
amen.
I got hope, I have no fear, amen. Because I have all that, I can give glory to God this morning. Boy, I'm about to have a spell up here this morning, amen. God is good. Genesis chapter number 50, verse number 15.
The Bible says, and when Joseph's brethren saw that their father was dead, they said, Joseph will peradventure hate us and will certainly requite us all the evil which we did unto him. And they sent a messenger unto Joseph, saying, thy father did command before he died, saying, so shall ye say unto Joseph, forgive, I pray thee now, the trespass of thy brethren and their sin. For they did unto thee evil, and now we pray thee, forgive the trespass of the servants of the God of thy father. And Joseph wept when they spake unto him. And his brethren also went and fell down before his face, and said, behold, we be thy servants. And Joseph said unto them, fear not, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, ye thought evil against me. But God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive. Let us pray. Lord, we come to you today. God, I thank you for your presence here this morning. God, I thank you, Lord, for being faithful, Lord, to always be your servant, to always, Lord, give you what I stand in need of. Lord, I feel your presence all around this place. I pray that it would go through that little camera hole in that phone, God, and flow out into every living room or every deck or every swing or wherever someone may be sitting this morning, Lord, worshiping you or standing, Lord, as we read the Word of God. I pray, God, that you just touch them, equip us, give us what we stand in need of. Lord, we worship you this morning for it. We'll give you all the things. Lord, it's all you. It's always been about you. It'll always be about you. Lord, just help us to conform to you, God, what you have us to be. Ask you to lead, God, and direct us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to preach on this thought this morning, from the pit to the palace. From the pit to the palace. Now, if you don't know the story of Joseph, there may be some this tuning in this morning that's not a church regular. They never really attended much church, never been to Sunday school much, never been to vacation Bible school very much in their life. You may not know the story of Joseph. I'm going to give you some background on him here in just a few moments. But if you have, if you've been to church, if you've been to Sunday school, if you've been to vacation Bible school, you've heard the story of Joseph many times. You know of his story. You know how he suffered great many things in his life, but how God promoted him into a place of power so he could preserve his people, so he could carry on that line of Abraham. Some would look at the story of Joseph and say this: it is a story of injustice. It's a story of injustice. I'll say this morning. You could actually truly say that Joseph experienced injustice in his life. The Bible says that he was a good man. It doesn't say he was perfect. He was not perfect. We know there's never been but one in this world that was born a perfect man, and that's right. Jesus Christ. All the rest of us have come short of the mark. Right. But Joseph was as good as you could be, I guess. He didn't have any faults. He was just born. He was his father's favorite. And because he was his father's favorite, his brothers hated him. Because his brothers hated him, they picked him up and they threw him in a pit and they sold him into slavery. That was unjust. He didn't do anything to his brothers other than just be his father's favorite, and they threw him in a pit. He also suffered injustice down at Potiphar's house when his wife began to tell stories and tell lies about him. Can I say this? Joseph kept his character. Joseph stood in integrity. Joseph did not do that which was wrong. And can I say this? He could have easily done that. Nobody would have known. He could have done it and nobody would have known. He could have got away with it. But he kept his integrity. He kept his character. And because of that, he lost all that he had. He didn't have a whole lot, but what he did have, he lost. And they threw him into prison. So he was served injustice in that situation. He was lied upon. And the lie was believed. But can I say, all those injustices led him to the place where God could promote him. Some would say that his story is a story of injustice and hardship. That's absolutely true. It's a story of suffering, a story of all these types of things. But I believe this morning. I believe when we get to heaven and we are able to see Joseph face to face, And we're able to walk the streets of gold and pick his mind and just say, Joseph, how did you get through all that you went through? And if you ask Joseph what his story is about, I believe Joseph will say to us, and I believe if we could ask him this morning, what is my story about, Joseph? What is your story about? He would say, it's a story of provision. Amen. It's a story of a God that provided for him through every step of his life. I believe he'd say it's a story of protection. Amen. Anywhere along his trail of his life, he could have lost his life. He could have lost his way. But God protected him and kept him protected. And I believe he'd say this is a story of preservation. Amen. He would say, God preserved. He preserved my family. He preserved me. And he was doing all of this for his honor and for his glory. And we didn't even see it. I believe he'd say it's a story of preservation. It's a story filled with tests. He was tested in many ways. And can I say this? Life is filled with tests. Some tests life gives us are easier completed than others. Some of them are very hard tests. Right now, we're going through somewhat of a hard test. Many would say, oh, this is the hardest thing I've ever had to go through in my life. This virus, being separated, being all these things, this is hard. It's a hard test. But I tell you, for some, they would say, this is not very hard at all. I've been through things a whole lot worse than this. But some tests are hard, some tests are easy. But with each test comes a promotion. I want you to understand that this morning. The purpose of test in our life is so God can test us and then promote us. Many tests come for promotion. You say, well, what do you mean by that, preacher? Think about this. In school, when your children go to school, before they can be promoted from one grade to the next, what do they have to go through? A test. They have to be tested on the things that they were taught, the knowledge that they received that year. And if they do well on that test, if they make the passing grade, then they are promoted. Many times in life, tests come, and we, through those tests, are then promoted. Usually, those tests to promote are pretty hard. I want to give you an illustration this morning. I want to share a story with you of a man that was in college. This man was in college, and he was taking a class in ornithology, which is a study of birds. I didn't know that either. Some of you was like, what in the world is ornithology? I didn't know what that was. I had to look it up. It's a study of birds. I guess he was going to be a specialist in birds. But the professor was he had a reputation for giving very hard tests. And he had one coming up, and the man knew that. He said, I want to pass this grade, this test. I want to get my degree. I was going to study, so he studied so very hard. He studied every species of birds. He studied their feather types. He studied their feather colorings. He studied their size. He studied their beaks. He studied their eyes. He studied everything about those birds, so he would be prepared for the test. Can I say something right here? Give me a timeout for just a minute. We need to prepare for the test of our lives as well. This man was preparing. There's going to be tests in our life. We need to prepare for them. You say, well, how do you get prepared for the test of life? Through the Word of God. Amen. Amen. All right, time back here, and I'm going to go back to my story. Amen. He prepared really hard for that test. He got there on the day of the test, walked into the room where the test would be administered, and said about the time the professor got up, and he had 25 pictures that he posted and taped upon the board. He asked, he told the class, he said, this is the test. He said, you have to identify each bird by this picture. And each picture, all it was a picture of the feet of a bird. The man was like, what are you talking about? This is ridiculous. How are we supposed to know what kind of bird this is by his feet? He said, well, that's the test. He had studied everything about the bird itself. Their feet, amen, he'd study. Can I tell you this? All birds' feet look the same, amen. So this guy was very upset. He said, this is ridiculous. I am not going to take this test. The professor looked at him and said, if you don't take this test, I'm going to fail you. He said, I don't care if you fail me or not. I'm not taking this test. This is ridiculous. So the professor looked at the student. He said, okay, I'm going to fail you. What is your name? The student stood up, pulled his pants leg up really high, and he said, "You guess." Amen. He wanted to see what he looked like by his feet. Amen. He couldn't tell who his name was by his feet. How was he supposed to tell what a bird was by his feet? Amen. But listen, that was a hard lesson. That was a hard test. Life's full of tests. And I believe the people of God are experiencing a test right now. One of these tests that we're going through, God is taking us through something right now. This virus that we're still dealing with is a test. It's a test for our faithfulness. Are we going to trust God in the hardest times of our life? Are we going to trust God when things look the bleakest in our life? This is a test of faith. Are we going to trust Him when we can't see the purpose in what's going on? I want you to know something. I don't understand a whole lot. I got a very small mind. And I've really tried hard to understand what God is doing. I don't know if God sent this virus. I don't know if God just allowed the virus. He either sent it or He allowed it. I don't know. I cannot figure that out. I'm just going to trust God in it. But I want to see the purpose in it. I've been trying to find, God, what are you trying to do through all this? What are you showing us? What is it that we can learn? I've tried to figure it out, but my mind is not capable of comprehending the purpose. But I want you to understand something. You may not be able to understand it either. Just because I can't understand the purpose does not mean I cannot trust God in it. Amen. So many times when we don't understand what God is doing, we say, "Well, God, if I can't understand it, I can't trust you." That's the wrong thing to do, church. We are to trust God even in the midst of our not understanding. We are to trust God even when we don't understand what we're going through. I believe it's a test of faith. I believe what we're going through is a test of presence. In this time of social distancing, I think probably the hardest thing, the hardest thing for this preacher is the absence of people. Oh, I want to see you. I want to shake hands with you. I want to go back to the old way. I know we're not going to be able to do everything like we used to do, but I want you to know something. I miss you. Church, I miss you with all my heart. I want to see your faces in this auditorium. I want to see you holding your hands high. I want to hear you saying amen. The hardest thing for me has been the absence of the presence of the people of God. For many of us, we've been absent from our families. Just our very immediate families that we have lived with is all we've been associated with. Those other ones, we've had to be distanced from. But you know who we can still be close to in this time? In this time of social distancing, you know who we don't have to social distance from? That's the presence of the Lord God, our Savior. Amen. He's still close. The Bible says we'll draw nigh unto God. He'll draw nigh unto us. And every day of my life, I try to draw nigh to Him so He'll draw nigh unto me. We can still be in the presence of the Almighty God. But the problem is a lot of us won't even get in the presence then. A lot of us, before all this started, we didn't carry anything for the presence of God. A lot of people didn't. And even now, we still don't care about the presence of God. But I believe He's testing His people. Do you want to be in my presence? I want you to know if you do, you can be in it at any time you want. The Bible says God inhabits the praise of His people. Amen. You know how you want to get God to show up? Just start praising Him. Amen. Yes. He'll show up right where you are at. It's a test of presence. It's also a test of patience. One of the hardest things for a child of God to do in this time is to wait on God. How many of y'all, I want to say a show of hands. I'll go back and watch later and see if I see everybody. How many of you have to deal with a lack of patience? Amen. There's three. There's four of us here. Somebody ain't got their hand up today. Amen. Miss Nicole's got plenty of patience. I'll give her a pass on that one. I deal with a lack of patience. Oh, I need patience. God, give me patience. There's many of you here this morning that are listening to this, and you probably say the same thing. Boy, I need God to give me some patience. I need patience on this because I so wanted to have church today. Today was the day that I wanted to have church. I wanted you to come back in. I wanted all this to end. Listen, I wanted all this to end weeks ago. I would have never thought when we started this we'd have been 2 months into it doing a live service. This is the second month. Today makes the eighth week, two full months that we've done an online service. My patience ain't got enough. I ain't got enough patience for that. Lord, I need you to get it out and get it done. But listen, I want you to understand something. God works on His time and not on mine. Right. He works on His time and not on yours. God is showing us patience. He's doing something. We may not understand what it is. We may not know what it is. But God is doing something, and He is doing something in His own time. We just have to be patient. Will we learn to be patient through all of this? To help us show us these things, I want to just look at the life of Joseph for just a moment. Give you the background of Joseph really quick. Joseph was the 11th son of Jacob. We know Jacob was the son of Isaac. Isaac was the son of Abraham. And Joseph was his 11th son. He was born to his favorite wife. Do you remember? If you remember the story of Jacob, he went off and he ran for his life from Esau. He went to his uncle's house, Laban's house. And there he met the most beautiful woman that he had ever seen before. Her name was Rachel. As soon as he saw her, he was starstruck. He was love struck. And he said, "That's the one I want to marry." He went back and told her daddy. He said, "Listen, whatever I got to do to marry her, I'm going to marry her." He said, "You got to work 7 years." He said, "That's fine." He worked 7 years, the best 7 years of his life, the fastest 7 years of his life, because every day he looked forward to marrying his love. After those 7 years was up, he was married. Thought he had married Rachel, ended up in the morning marrying Leah, the oldest of the siblings. Laban had done a switcheroo on him, and it wasn't who he loved, but it was his wife, and he kept her. And he said, "Listen, we bartered and we agreed that I would marry Rachel." Laban said, "Well, if you want to marry her, you got to work 7 more years. He worked 7 more years to get her. Because he did, he loved her so very much. But this was the problem. Leah was very fertile and she had him many sons, but Rachel could not. Rachel was barren. Then one day God opened the womb of Rachel, and because he did, she was born unto him a son named Joseph. And the Bible says in Genesis chapter 37 that it was his favorite son. Verse 3 says, "Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a coat of many colors." He was his favorite son. Because he was his favorite son, that made all his other sons very upset. How many of you know it's not good to have favorites with your children? Amen. There may be some that that it's just not a good thing to have favorites with children. We are to love all of our children all the same. Listen, we pattern our love of our children on God's love of his children. You know why? Because God loves all of us the same. He can't love us anymore. He can't love us any less. And we are to do that with all of our children. But he loved him, and it caused his brothers to get upset with him. They hated him for this. They hated him because he loved because Jacob loved him more. So they deceived a plot and said, "We're going to get rid of this guy." He had also had some dreams. God had divinely given him dreams, showing him what was about to take place in his life. And he shared those dreams with his brother. And he said, "Listen, we were all out gathering wheat one day, and the ones that I had gathered, my sheep stood up, and all your sheep bowed down." He said, "That's showing me that one day y'all are going to all bow down to me." Boy, they didn't already like him. Now they really hated him. They was getting ready to get rid of him. He also had another dream that said all the moon and the stars made obeisance to him. And he said this is a great dream. He said, "It's been divinely given to me." And boy, his family really hated him because of that. Even Jacob questioned him on his dreams, but they were divinely given. But his brothers decided they were going to put him in a pit. They devised a plan to kill him. They decided not to kill him, but they'll throw him in a pit. Let me ask you a question today. Have you ever felt like your life was in a pit? You ever felt like you've been in the pits of life? Like everything was going wrong and there was no way for you to get out of the pit? Sometimes, man, I felt like my life has been like that. I mean, I'm in a pit and it ain't going nowhere. That's where Joseph found himself, in a pit. We all have those pits from time to time. We all go through the pits. Life sometimes can put you in the pits. But I'm here to tell you, it don't matter if you get in a pit or not, you can get through the pit. Right. What's our first reaction when we find ourselves in the pits of life? We say this: "Why am I here? Why am I in a pit? How did I get here? Why is this happening? Why? Most of us always ask why we're in a pit. Can I say the first thing that we need to do to combat asking why is to take a look in the mirror. You say, "Well, there ain't no mirror in the pit." That's right, but you got to do a self-examination. Examine our own self. Did I do something to get here? Was it my fault? Was something I said or something I did? Many people in the Bible have gone through these situations, pits of life. May not be literal pits, but
hard times. One of them I think of is Job. Oh, Job was one of the greatest men of the Bible. I love reading the story of Job. In Job chapter 6, verse 24, after all that Job went through, he asked the Lord, he said this, "Teach me, and I will hold my tongue, and cause me to understand wherein I have erred." He said, "God, I don't know why all this is happening, but if it's something I've done, would you show me what it was?" Now, you and I know the story of Job. The Bible says in Job chapter 1 that he was a perfect and upright man. Didn't mean he didn't sin, but just means he lived his life in a right way, and he was upright with God. He eschewed evil. We know that he did nothing wrong, according to the scriptures, to have all that come apart. It was just a test. It was a trial that God was sending him through. But Job said this, "Lord, if it's something that I've done that's caused this to come on me, would you show it to me so I can repent of it, so I can get it out?" First thing we need to do is look and see, hey, did I get myself in this pit? Because a lot of times we do. Job didn't. We know Joseph didn't do anything to get him in the pit. He was just living his life, and his brothers hated him, and they threw him in the pit. His pit was part of God's plan. This pit that Joseph found himself in was part of God's plan. David did this as well. He asked the Lord this in Psalms chapter 139, verse number 23 and 24. He says this, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Can I tell you, that's a good prayer for all of us to pray every day of our life. "Lord, search me, O Lord. See if there be any wicked way in me. Try my hearts and try my thoughts. And if there be any wicked way, remove them." I tell you, that gets a whole lot closer to God if we pray that prayer every day. That gets a whole lot better relationship with God if we search us out. Because I can tell you, if God starts searching in our hearts and in our thoughts, he's going to find some things that he'll highlight. And can I tell you, when he highlights something in your life, you need to deal with it right then. Get rid of it right then. You know what's amazing about Job and Joseph and Daniel? Hey, listen, I think about Daniel being in the lion's den. Amen. He didn't do anything to get there except do what God had called him to do. Hey, he was faithful to God. He continued to pray. He ended up in the lion's den. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego ended up in the fire. They didn't do anything but stand for God. Peter, hey, listen, he went through all kind of trials and tribulations, all because he stood and preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul was shipwrecked and all different types of things and actually put to death because he preached the gospel, spent most of his life in a prison cell somewhere because he preached the gospel. They all found themselves in the pits of life. And none of them was their fault. Now listen, if those great men of God can find themselves in a pit of life and they have done nothing wrong, don't you think that God sometimes can use a pit of life to show you or get you somewhere you need to be? You may be in a pit right now. You may be going through the hardest thing. I'm talking about outside this virus. You may be going through the hardest thing you've ever went through and you're crying out, "God, why am I here?" It may be because God needs you there. God wants to show you something there. God wants to take you somewhere there. I want you to know, out of Joseph's test came promotion. He was sold. He wasn't killed. He was sold into slavery down into Egypt. How many of you know that God had a plan? I could just imagine Joseph being in that pit thinking, "Lord, I don't know what you're doing. I don't know why I'm here. I hadn't done anything wrong." And him thinking in his mind, everything was working against him. Have you ever felt like in your life everything was working against you? I have. Boy, sometimes I feel like that almost every day. Like, "Lord, why is everything working against me?" Have you ever felt like everything was working against you? This is the thing. I'm sure Joseph might have those feelings in his heart that everything was working against him. But in reality, in truth, everything was working for him. That's only God can do that. Hey, man, can I tell you, Romans 8, 28, for all things, for the Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, says this, "And we know that all things work together for good to those that are called, to those that are the called, to those that love God." Listen, he can take all the bad things in life, the good things in life, the ugly things in life, work them all together and make you think everything is falling apart. And what he's really doing is building you up. Amen. Yeah. God can do that. That's only God right there. That's exactly what was happening in Joseph's life. So how did he get through it? The question is this morning, how do we get through those times of life? You may be experiencing them. If you're not experiencing them now, can I say this? They're probably coming down the road. And if you're not experiencing them right now, you might have had some in your past. So how do you get through them? Three quick things this morning. I know I'm running late this morning, but three quick things. Number one, how do you get through the pits of life? Number one, faith in God. Joseph must have had questions in the pit. The Bible never shares that. The Bible never tells us that he even one time questioned what God was doing. But I'm sure in his flesh, there were some thoughts of those questions. But one thing it does tell us that he always kept his faith in God. He had faith during these times. He kept faith when he went through. He continued to trust God. He continued to live with integrity in every place. I tell you, sometimes when we get some bad things happen, we'll say, well, I ain't worried about that. I ain't got to live good no more. I ain't got to do anything. These bad things have happened in my life. I just live however I want to. Can I tell you, child of God, you make it do that. And you do have the free will to do that, but you'll never be satisfied. You'll never be happy in your life until you live according to the God. But I'm telling you, Joseph, that was in the worst situations anybody could ever find himself in, continued to live in integrity, continued to live with the character that God had instilled in him, continued to trust in God. And everywhere he was at, he had joy in his heart. Amen. Even in the pit, even in the prison, even in Potiphar's house, even wherever he went, he had joy. Because he continued to live with God. Can I say this? Colossians chapter number 3, verse number 22, verse number 3, 22 through 24 says this. Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. And whatsoever you do, do it heartily as unto the Lord and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. The Bible says continue to do everything that you do. Do it not for men, but do it unto the Lord. That means when you're on a job that you can't stand, where your boss is doing you wrong, where your boss is treating you bad, sometimes it's tempting to give up and just say, I'm not going to do anything for that person because they're just so terrible. He or she has been terrible to me. But the Bible says obey. Servants, obey all things your masters. And that's what he's saying, those that are in authority above you. And do it not unto them, but do it unto God. Lord, help me to take my own preaching this morning and do what you call me to do. Do what God has called me to do unto me and not unto men. Listen, I'm here to tell you this morning, we'll continue to walk in integrity. We can continue to walk. No, did you know no matter what circumstance you're in, you can still honor God by your walk? No matter if you're in a pit or if you're in a trial, others can see you in that pit or see you in that trial and say, man, that person right there has got to have a relationship with God because they are still walking in integrity. They have not lost their cool. They have not lost their way. It's faith. Joseph had faith in the Word of God. He had faith that the Word of God that has spoken to him. Listen, y'all remember those dreams I talked about? Joseph knew those were divine. He knew he didn't just dream them up out of his imagination. He knew they were divinely spoken unto him. And he knew that God had a plan. He knew that he not only knew that God had a plan, but he believed God's plan. That one day that his brothers would bow down, one day that the moon and the stars would make obeisance to him. He believed that. And he continued to believe it, and he continued to walk by faith. Even in his pit, he remembered what God had told him. Listen, the Word of God will tell you the truth about your life. And listen, that we are all, God is always with us. He'll never leave us, nor will he ever forsake us. He is always going to be with us. He's going to always give us, fulfill his promises that he's made to us. And if you'll take this Word of God as truth, because it is, you won't have to worry about all the things that you lost. You'll realize all the things that you still have. Faith got him through his pit. Now listen, I want to jump back really quick. Do you remember when I said sometimes when you find yourself in a pit, you got to look in the mirror and question, was it something I done? I gave you several examples of men that did nothing that got up in a pit. I'm going to give you an example one, and now they did everything that caused them to get in a pit. You remember the story of the prodigal son? The prodigal son said, Lord, Daddy, I can't wait till you die. Give me all my money now. I'm ready to go. He made a bad decision, went off and spent all that he had.
and righteous living and high living. He did all that, spent all that he had, then he began to be in want, and he found himself in a pig pen. You know why he was in the pig pen? Because of the choices he made.
That's right.
Because of his choices. Listen, Joseph didn't do anything to get in the pit. Daniel didn't do anything to get in the lion's den. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego didn't do anything to get in the fire. But the prodigal son put himself in the pig pen. Sometimes we'll find a pit, but we'll get in a pit of life because of something we've done. By the same token, we got to examine ourselves. Remember David said, "Search me, O God, see if there be any wicked thing in me." Hey, the old prodigal son, when he was down in the pig pen, he began to examine himself. This is what it says in verse 17. And when he came to himself, you know what that means? He means he examined his decisions. He examined his life, and he realized. He saw the truth. It was my decisions that caused me to be here. He examined himself, and when he came to himself, he said, "I'll go back to my father's house." You know what got him out of the pit? Faith got Joseph out. Faith kept Joseph going. You know what got the prodigal son out? Repentance. He says, "Lord, forgive me." He went back to his father. He said, "I don't deserve to be your son anymore, but if you just make me your servant, I'll serve you the rest of my days." He repented. He repented of his decisions. Amen. And because he repented of his decisions, the father fell on his neck, kissed him, loved him, put a new ring and a new robe, killed the fatted calf, and had worship, amen, because he came back. Hey, listen, repentance got him out. Sometimes faith will get you through it, but sometimes repentance will get you out of it as well. When he came to himself, he looked in the mirror. Number two, the presence of God. The next thing that got Joseph through the pits of life was the presence of God. In chapter 37 of Genesis, three times, as it's talking here, maybe in chapter 39, three times as it's talking here, it says of Joseph's life, the Lord was with Joseph. Chapter 39, verse 2. And the Lord was with Joseph. When he was in Potiphar's house, the Lord was with Joseph. Listen, faith in God got him out. The presence of God kept him going. What kept him going through the pits of life? Faith in God and the presence of God. Aren't you thankful? Aren't you thankful this morning, church, that wherever you are, whatever you're going through, you can have peace. You can have no fear because the presence of God is so near. Hey, listen, God will be with you in the pits. He was with Joseph. God will be with you in the fire. He was with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He'll be with you in the lion's den. He was with Daniel. He'll be with you in the storm. He was with the disciples as they sailed across that sea and the storms come. He'll be with you in prisons. Amen. I hope none of you ever go to prisons, but listen, he'll be with you there. We also support a bunch of missionaries that's going to people in prisons. And a lot of folks have forgot about them men and women there and that are in those prisons. But I'm here to tell you, God can still be with them. God can rehab their life. God can turn them around as well. Listen, he'll be with you there. It may not be a literal prison that you're in, but it may be a spiritual prison. God will still be with you there. He'll be with you in troubles. Hey, listen, he's with us. And if he's with us, who can be against us? Romans chapter 8, verse 31 says, if God be for us, who can be against us? I say this, if God be with us, who can be against us? Amen. He's with us this morning. The presence of God. Lastly, this morning, I want you to know that what got him through was not only the faith in God and the presence of God, but patience with God. We often read stories in the Bible of these great characters, and they only last a few chapters. Some of them maybe one chapter. And we think, boy, and we see of their terrible troubles. We see of the terrible trials that they go through. We read for about 10 minutes through each and every chapter, and then it's over. We see God intervene. We see God move, and we see and say, boy, God, he really spoke to him. He really stilled their storm. And what we think is, in the time that we read that, that's the time that God moved. It took him 10 minutes to do that. I want you to know it only takes just about 10 minutes to read the story of Joseph. But can I tell you this? It wasn't just 10 minutes that he was in a pit. It wasn't just 10 minutes he was in the prison. Sure. He spent a lot of time that way. And he had to have patience with God. I think it's about 13 years from the time he was sold into slavery until the time that God promoted him out of it. He went through these trials and sufferings. 13 years. Lord, help us. Lord, help us to have patience with God. We've been for 8 weeks now, and I'm about to fall apart because I want to go back to the church. And listen, can I tell you, we need patience in this time. More than anything else, we need patience with God and realize God is doing. For 13 years, Joseph had patience with God and said, God, I don't know what you're doing, but I know you're doing something. I'm just going to trust you. Day after day for 13 years, even after setback, when it looked like everything was going to fall apart, he said, God, I'm just going to trust you. And in your time, you do what you want to do. He had patience with God. We need patience with God today, brother and sister. I'm not just talking about this virus. I'm talking about whatever you're dealing with God. There's some people that's been praying for a long time about specific things, and God's not moved yet. Have patience. You may have to pray for years before God. It's time for God to move. But can I say this? When it's time for him to move, and when he moves, it'll be the right time.
That's right.
He's never late. He's never early. He's right on time every time.
Amen.
Just keep praying. Just keep having patience. There may be some of you dealing with financial issues, and you don't know how you're going to get out of them. Be patient and let God work and let God do it. Let God do something if you'll just have patience with God. So many times our patience runs so thin, we try to get ahead of God. Don't get ahead of him. Just wait on him. The only thing we see in Joseph's life is this. He never tried to get ahead of God. He never tried to get out of the pit. He never tried to get out of Potiphar's house. He never tried to get out of the prison before God wanted him to get there. And when it was God's time, he got in there. Look what it says in Romans chapter 5, verses 3 and 5. And not only so, we glory in tribulations, also knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. The Bible says tribulation worketh patience. Patience worketh hope. Hope builds character to witness to others about God. We need to have patience in God. In the pits of life, have patience. Can I tell you this morning? With patience comes renewed energy. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31 says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. Those that wait upon the Lord. But those that work in their own strength wear out, burn out, get done, overdo it. But those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Patience, with patience comes promotion. Out of the pit, into Potiphar's house. Out of Potiphar's house, into the prison. And finally, out of the prison, into promotion. Listen, I hope you understand. I don't have time to share with you the whole story of Joseph this morning. Please go back and read it for yourself as he came out of the pit. But when it got time for God to promote him through faith, through his presence, and through patience, God promoted him to a place of prominence. He had a dream. Pharaoh had a dream. Nobody could interpret it. The butler or the one that was in the jail with him remembered that he interpreted his dream. He sent word to the Pharaoh that Joseph could interpret it. He came in. He interpreted the dream. Pharaoh said, I think there's a better man on the face of this planet to understand and guide us through what's about to happen except you. And he took him from a pit to a palace. Listen, he put him in second in command. 13 years before, he was in a pit. But now he's in a palace. He's in a pit, from a pit to a palace. Can I tell you, that's what God can do. If you're in a pit right now, don't worry. There may be a palace coming. There may be peace coming. There may be all these things coming. God can do that. But I want you to understand this, and I'm done. God's promotion often comes from the hardest situations. Joseph, Moses, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Daniel, Peter, Paul, and even Jesus Christ was promoted. You remember when he hung on that cross and died and they put him in that borrowed tomb? He rose on the third day, and then after many days that he spent with his disciples, you know what happened? He was promoted back to heaven. But it came from the hardest situations of life. I want to give you this. Would you have patience with God's plan today? Child of God, whatever you're going through, please keep faith, look for his presence, and have patience. I bet he had a lot of time to think going through those things. Those 13 years, can you imagine how much stuff you can think about in 13 years? He had a lot of time to think. I'm sure in his flesh through those 13 years, he probably thought that day that his brothers throwed him in the pit was probably one of the worst days of his life. My son, I laugh at this. I've been holding this for a long time. He knows something about being in a pit. KC works with me every day, and we work and we do chickens and things, and the way we dispose of them, we dig a big hole and we put a top on it and then we put them in there. And there was just a few chickens we had put in there. One day he was standing on the top and he was about to put some more in. And as he was standing there, that top gave way and he failed all the way to the bottom of that pit, about 15 feet. Praise the Lord, he wasn't injured. Praise the Lord, he wasn't hurt severely. Could have been crushed, could have been something really bad happened, but he fell in that pit. And I told him as we talked about it many times, that verse in Psalms chapter 40, verse 2 is going to take on a whole new meaning to you, where it says, God brought me up out of a horrible pit. You don't get a more horrible pit than what KC was in, one where dead carcasses was at. He stayed in there for a while, and we got him out, praise the Lord, pulled him out, but I pick at him all the time about it. When we get around, I say, why don't you walk out over that pit? He said, I ain't getting on that. He said, I don't care what happened. I'm not getting back on that pit. He said, that was the worst day of my life. I pray that is the worst day of his life. I really do. Because that day wasn't all really that bad. I pray that he can say that when he dies, that's the worst day of his life, the day he fell in the chicken pit. But I'm sure Joseph fought that too. But as God began to play out his plan in his life, I believe Joseph, at some point, I said, that's the worst day of my life. But as God began to play out his plan, I believe Joseph began to see this. That really wasn't the worst day of my life. That's probably the best day of my life. You say, Brother Kevin, how could you say that? That's the best day of Joseph's life. Because that's the day that God began him on his journey to preserve his people, to provide for his people. He probably knew, if I wouldn't have got put in the pit, I'd have never got to Potiphar's house. If I never got to Potiphar's house, I never got put into prison. If I'd never been in prison, that butler would not have known that I could interpret the dream. And if I wouldn't have been in the prison, I never made it to the palace. But because I was in the pit, I made it to the palace. Amen. And because I was in the palace, my people came one day looking for food. My brothers that put me in that pit came looking for food, and I was able to provide for them and my whole family. Hey, and because of that, I was able to preserve my family name. I was able to preserve the line of Jesus Christ. Amen. And when his brothers came to him, they said, hey, Joseph, please don't do us wrong. He said, who am I? Do you think I'm in the place of God? He said, you thought it for evil against me, but God meant it for good. I'm here to tell you, say some of you going through some things this morning that you think it's the worst thing in your life, but God means it for good. God's going to use it for good. God's going to bring the best thing of your life out of this situation if you'll just trust him, keep your faith in him, live in his presence during these times, and have patience. Listen, the devil may mean a lot of things for evil, but God can use it for good. I believe the devil meant this virus for evil, but I believe God's used it for good. I know he has.
Yes.
Know he has. God meant it for good. Would you have faith? Would you develop patience? Would you enjoy his presence this morning? If you'll do that, God will take you from a pit to a palace. I want to read you this last verse of scripture. I'm done. Psalms chapter number 40, verse number 2 says this. He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon the rock, and established my goings. And he hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God, and many shall see it, and fear, and shall trust in the Lord. The Bible says when we were lost, undone without God, living in sin, we were in a horrible pit. But it said Jesus picked us up out of that horrible pit, set our feet upon a rock, washed us clean as white as snow, saved us, redeemed us, and put us on a path of glory. Hey, listen, once you got saved, he picked you up out of that pit.
And he set you on a course for a palace. Amen. The Bible doesn't call a palace causing a mansion. Amen. But I believe it's probably going to be the same thing. Amen. Yes. He can take you this morning from a pit to a palace. He can take you from a pit to a mansion if you'll just trust in him. Somebody's listening to this morning that doesn't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. I'm here to tell you, all you got to do is call upon his name. He'll lift you up out of the pit. He'll put you on course for a mansion one day in glory. And you'll go from a pit to a palace. I can't wait till I get there. Amen. It's going to be a wonderful time. And hey, listen, the only reason I'm going is because of what Jesus did for me. I'm telling you, if you're going to get there, it's going to be through the blood of Jesus Christ. Listen, if you're lost, I want you to understand this morning. All you got to do is ask him into your heart to redeem you and be saved. For you that are saved and are the saints of God that are watching this morning, have faith. Dwell in his presence. And let's have patience. God doing something big in this whole ordeal. I love you this morning. Let us pray. Lord, I love you. Thank you for your good word. I ask you to use it for your honor and your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.